Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We have been preparing for the past 3 weeks about a new series that we're starting today called Now is the Time. We've been preparing for it, so we're going to launch into this new series today called Now is the Time. As a family, as a POW family, we have been preparing, waiting to hear those words from our daughter, Now is the Time. Many of you know our daughter and son-in-law, they are expecting. She's really expecting, and she could go literally any moment. If you hear a cry from the little balcony there, it's just because now's the time, and Jay will come up and finish this message. But we've been preparing. We've been waiting for this. We've been awaiting the arrival of Piper Joy Stevens, and we've just been so excited about it. So excited, so in preparing that the phone's beside the bed all the time. The other morning, I don't know, it was a little bit after midnight, I think it was, I heard my wife's phone go off. I said, "What's going on?" "Haley has contractions. She's had four of them, but 10 minutes apart." I'm thinking, "Oh God, here we go." Fell back asleep. 15 minutes later, text went off again. "Oh, false alarm. Thank you for letting me know. So kind of you, pumpkin. So kind." Every time, we just wait and everything, and close. Baby clothes. We're the grandparents. I thought that once the kids were grown and out of the house, what's the use of buying clothes now? And now that we have, and this is the thing about grandkids. Each time you buy one outfit for one, she isn't even here yet. She has more clothes than I do. She isn't even here yet, and she has Christmas gifts at her house. We've made preparations to hear those words. Now is the time. Now is the time for you. God has great things in store for you. He has some amazing things for each and every one of you. And I don't care your pedigree. I don't care which denominational background you come from. I don't care what family you come from. I am here today to let you know that God has some great things, some amazing things for you in your life if you just go after them. Now is the time to go after what God has for you. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, I want to read from the New International Version. For he says, in the time of my favor, I heard you. And in the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the time of salvation. That's what the word says. What time is it? How often do you ask that question or hear that question being asked every day? Our lives are driven by time. Time to go to work. Time to go to school, time to take the kids to practice, time for this appointment, time for that appointment, time for this deadline to be met, bedtime, and the list could go on and on. In fact, time is so important in our culture that many of us have multiple tech devices all connected to the same satellite that can tell us what time it is 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, wherever we're at. Does that ring a bell with anyone? We're all connected to time. And we can tell which time it is regardless of where we're at. Let me ask you a question. What time is it in your life? Where are you at in your life? I want to talk to you this morning about hope. Now is the time for hope. How many of you know we could use some hope? How many of you know as a nation, we could use a little bit of hope? As cities, we could use hope. How many of you know that as families, we could use hope, or as individuals, we could use hope? What is hope? Merriam-Webster defines hope as to want something to happen or be true, or think that it could happen or be true. Can I be honest with you? That doesn't encourage me too much about hope. But the biblical meaning of hope is this: a confident expectation, a sure desire. Merriam-Webster doesn't entice me too much to have hope, but God's meaning of hope encourages me to lay hold of hope. Where do we find genuine, real hope? In Colossians chapter 1, verse 27, the last part of that verse, it says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Can I tell you that the only real hope that we will ever find in this lifetime will be found in Jesus Christ? You'll not find it in Merriam-Webster, but you'll find it in Jesus Christ. You'll find real hope in the person of Jesus Christ, not just some thought up imaginary person, but the real divinical person of Jesus Christ. That's real hope in Christ, the hope of glory. In Him I find my hope. In Him I have hope. And this is the encouraging thing, is the closer you get to God, the more hope you'll have. Biblical hope is found in Jesus Christ. The power of hope, now get this, the power of hope comes from the one that is behind your hope. If I'm behind your hope, you're in trouble. Just look at your neighbor and shake your head and say, man, I am in trouble. But if Jesus Christ is behind your hope, it is assured. It's a confident thing. It's going to come to pass in your life. That's the difference of the world's hope and the biblical meaning of hope. The degree of hope increases because of the one that your hope is founded in. When my hope is in Jesus Christ, I'm assured it's going to happen. It isn't a question. It is not a maybe. The only thing is when it's going to happen. The degree of hope goes up. It increases based on who it is that's standing behind your hope. I know you love your husband and your wife, but they're going to let you down. You can hope they won't, but they're flesh and blood. They're going to let you down. But Jesus Christ, on the other hand, He is not a man that He should lie. And if your hope lives in Him, then it is assured He will bring it to pass in your life. Listen, listen, the more hope we have, the closer to God we are, the more hope we have. On the other hand, Job 8:13 says this, New Living Bible, those who forget God have no hope. Those who forget God have no hope. The most hopeless people on the face of the earth today are those who are far from God. Some of them once was walking very close and tightly with God. But somehow something happened in their life. Maybe something caused a fracture. Maybe some church people let them down. And they got a little bit separated from God. And the next thing you know, they are so far out there, it'll take Jesus Christ to bring them back. Why? Because those who forget God have no hope. Our hope does not lie within the person we put in the White House. I got to be honest with you. You turn on every political station, every news station, the first thing you hear is Hillary and Donald, Donald and Hillary. And I know that an election needs to take place. I get that. But this is what I want you to understand. Everybody's basing on what's going to happen in the world based on who we put in the White House. And I know the person we put in the White House is considered the most powerful man in the world or woman in the world. I get that. But let me tell you something. My hope is not based on who gets in the White House. My hope is founded on the one that went to the cross. That's where my hope is founded. My hope is built on nothing less. My hope is founded in Jesus Christ. The winds may blow and storms may come, but if my hope is in Jesus Christ, He is the one that solidifies me and He is the one that sustains me. Someone's going to be in a White House, but one went to the cross. And His name is Jesus. And He is the one that I place my trust. God is greater than government. I'm thankful for government. But God is greater than government. Talk a little bit about hope versus optimism. And don't get me wrong. I love optimistic people. But hope is not optimism. Hope is theological. Optimism is psychological. Optimism is Little Orphan Annie. I won't sing it. I'll spare you that. The sun will come out tomorrow. Truth is, it might not. You be as optimistic as you want to, but facts are, it'll only come out if my God says, come out. That's the power my God has. I'm thankful for optimistic people. I like optimistic people. They're better than lemon suckers, I'll tell you that. I'm thankful for optimistic people. There's nothing wrong with optimism, but optimism will not change the world. But a hope in Jesus Christ will transform nations, bless God. A hope in Jesus Christ will set captives free. A hope in Jesus Christ will change the world. Optimism will not. Optimism says, it isn't as bad as it seems. Hope says, it's bad. Sometimes hope says, it's as bad as it seems. It's really bad. But I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in the one that went to the cross. I believe he has the power to change anything he wants to. Oh, that's good. Optimism denies reality. It's a false hope. There's three types of hope I want to talk about this morning. I want to talk about wishful hope, expectant hope, and certain hope. Wishful hope is what you do when you're running late for work. Were you here at the 9? Wishful hope is what you do when you're late for work and you're sitting at a red light. I wish it would turn green. If that wishful stuff worked, that light would have never turned red to begin with because you spent too much time looking in the mirror. Oh. But that's wishful hope. It's wishful thinking. I hope they get here on time. I wish the church would show up on time. Well, let me get back here. It's safer back here. Hope they get here on time. Your kids never show up on time. My son, he loves to eat, but he's always the last one to the dinner. I'm talking about Evan. When he's grown up as a kid, he'd eat you out of house and home. Man, that boy could eat. And now we have a dinner house. He is the last one there, but he expects to be the first one in line. Wishful hope is false hope. I don't recommend this, but it's like somebody who's going to buy a lottery ticket. It's wishful hope. I hope I win. Can I be honest with you? You stand a better chance of getting struck by lightning than winning the lottery. I'll go further. It's going to blow your mind. I wish I'd win the lottery. You stand a greater chance of getting picked to make the next trip to the moon than you do winning the lottery. Well, I hope I win. Why don't you stop wasting your money and know you're not going to get a return and put it in God's kingdom where you're guaranteed. Oh, I'm not talking about tithing. I'm talking about hope here. Where you're guaranteed a return. This type of hope you cannot build a life on. Number two is expectant hope. It's a little better than wishful hope, but not much. Expectant hope is there is a reason for hope. I planted tomato seeds, so I hope I'll have some tomatoes. I have reason to hope because I've put something tangible in the ground and I can see it with my eyes, so therefore I can expect, hopefully, I'm going to reap what I've sown. Now, I got some news for you. I hope they grow, but you're not the only ones after those tomatoes, I found out. Deer like those tomatoes. Rabbits, squirrels. Then some of them even did grow when we even produced some tomatoes. Turtles. Turtles like tomatoes, but they were gracious. They only took one bite out of each one. So, I mean, it's okay. But expectant hope is, I have a reason for hope. I have something to expect. It's expecting hope. But it's not a guaranteed thing. A woman who's pregnant is expecting hope. And this is the thing about parents. We as parents, when we're expecting, we have all these lofty dreams of all the things our kids are going to achieve. They're going to be great. They're going to be perfect. I know there's never been another one besides Jesus perfect, but my baby's special. They'll never do anything wrong. I'll never have to correct my child because they're special. I'm just expecting they're going to be great. And then you have that baby. And reality sets in. They're not perfect. They tear up the house. They cost you money. They make messes. We watched our granddaughter Friday evening. And I walked through the dining room and I heard this kind of tinkling sound on the floor. And I walked in and she got the dog food out of the doggy bowl and thought it looked better on the floor. She threw up on me. I'm just sharing this exclusively in a 10:45. I didn't share it in 9 because I didn't know if they could handle it or not. But she made a mess. She puked all over me Saturday morning. I was sitting there in my shorts and my favorite T-shirt just having a great time watching Monsters, Inc. probably or something like that. It's glorious. And I'm sitting there and I hear her cough and I'm thinking this is not good, so I pull her into it. How'd I get off on that? We can expect them to be perfect. But that's just expecting hope. It's not guaranteed. It is not assured. But the third hope, certain hope. Certain hope or assured hope is a guarantee. We find this in Hebrews chapter 6, verses 13 through 19. Let me read these verses. For when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater one, he swore by himself, saying, surely blessing I will bless you, and multiplying I will multiply you. And so after he patiently endured, sometimes you have to go through something to receive this kind of hope. In fact, I can take you to scripture that will tell you that when you endure, it builds character, and character produces hope. There's this message out there right now that you, when you serve God, you don't have to work. You don't have to do anything. I don't know what Bible they're reading, but sometimes as children of God, you have to work. You have to apply yourself. So he said, after I patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For men indeed swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is for them an end of all dispute. Thus God determined to show more abundantly to his heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it but with an oath, that by two immutable things in which is impossible for God to lie, that's key, we must have strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold of the hope set before us. This hope we have as an anchor of our soul, both sure, steadfast, of which enters the presence behind the veil. Now, I don't have time to break all that down, but I want to talk to you about certain hope. Immutability and confirm. Immutability means unchangeableness of his purpose. That when God speaks something to you, you can guarantee it's going to come to pass. It's guaranteed. It's assured it's going to happen. You can anchor your life. You can anchor your soul in this hope we're talking about in this scripture. It's assured. You can anchor your life in it. Faith and hope are twin brothers. You can't have hope without faith, and you can't have faith without hope. Christian hope is found in Hebrews 6:19, the New Living Bible. The certain hope of being saved is a strong and trustworthy anchor for our souls. Salvation is found in no one else except Jesus Christ. You can only anchor your soul in his salvation. He's trustworthy. It's strong. It's dependable. It's reliable. You can bet your life on it. It is an anchor for your soul. Anchor. Let's talk a little bit about an anchor. An anchor. An anchor on a ship serves two purposes. One, the first purpose is it'll keep that ship from drifting. The second one is it'll keep it steady in a time of a storm. Well, it's okay. Everything's calm around me. I don't need the anchor. I don't care how calm the water is. You will still drift. Our lives are constantly in motion, one way or another. Either in peace or turmoil, but it's still in motion. And the only way that we stay on course is because of the anchor that we're in. Our lives are constantly drifting here or there if we do not have an anchor. This hope must be our anchor. If we don't have this anchor, we drift. We drift from God. If we don't have this anchor, we drift from our goals. We drift from the people who loves us. We drift from our dreams. We are constantly drifting if we are not anchored to Jesus Christ. Our lives are constantly being swayed by the winds, by the competition, by the accusations, by the pains and hurts, disappointments of life. But the second purpose of the anchor is to keep the ship steady in time of a storm. The bigger the ship, the bigger the anchor. If you want to live a big, full, abundant life that the Word of God declares you can have, then you're going to need a big anchor in your life. And that anchor is found in Jesus Christ. Why? Because there will be storms. This is not just drifting. These are storms that arise in our life. How many of you have ever been on a large ship in the middle of an outrageous storm with about 40-foot swells? Anybody? I mean, to where that ship was just felt like a little twig in a big, angry ocean. I've been there many times. I remember when I was in the service and we were making a North Atlantic cruise. And I remember a ship was never designed to stay in harbor. It was never designed to stay tied to a pier. A ship was designed to be out on the open sea. It's what it was created for. And I remember being in the service in the North Atlantic, that there would storms just blow in and blow up without any notice or warning at all. It wasn't anything, and our ship was 644 feet long, was 150 feet wide, and I think it was about 12 stories tall. And it wasn't anything that for that ship to go into a storm, and as long as the ship is capable of making forward progress, it can weather any storm. But sometimes you get in the middle of a storm and you get in trouble and you lose power or you have to stop. And if you don't drop anchor, that angry sea will carry you miles off your course. I remember when I was in the service, we were in the North Atlantic and we were in a terrible storm and the ship was just rocking side to side. You know it's bad that when you go to sleep at night, you have to sleep with your legs spread apart and your elbows out. If you don't, you'll roll across the floor. It's the truth. And I remember I was on watch down in the engine room. And there was a general quarters that sounded because we had just lost a man over to the side. Petty officer, third class Flood, boatswain's mate. He fell into 34-degree water. And one thing you find out when you're in a naval fleet is anytime the government sends the fleet out, you may look out on that boat and see no one else around you, but they never send one ship out by itself. There's always a fleet. There's always aircraft carriers. There are always fast frigates and battleships and helo carriers and destroyers all around you. You may not see them, but they're there. And as soon as he fell over the side, but the naval standard is you stop the ship right there and you drop the anchor. And when we dropped that anchor, the ship continued to roll side to side and up and down. But that anchor held us firmly on course. It did not move. It kept us right where we were supposed to be. I watched down in main control. We had a ballast level. It looked like an upside down U.
And it's good when that bubble's right in the middle. It's calm. But when that bubble's resting at the end of that thing, the ship is literally laying on its side in that angry ocean. And you'll lay on its side. You could literally walk on the walls. And then all at once that ship would come right back up. Why? Because that anchor that no one could see was holding that ship firmly in place. All 1,200 people on board that ship was held on course by that one anchor. They may not have realized it, but that's what held us in place.
During the storm, that one anchor held us all where we were supposed to be. Now listen to me. Maranatha, our purpose must always be to get people to Jesus Christ. It can never be to get them to a church or this church or a person. It is always to get people to Jesus Christ. I'm still on the anchor, just bear with me. Remember last week when I told you that we collectively as a body and also individuals as the church, we had a responsibility and authority in this valley? That if we did not stand in our role, it gave the enemy legal access to all the ones that had been entrusted to our care. Anybody remember that? If it holds true in that way in the negative, then it also has to hold true in the positive. If our hope is in Jesus Christ, it will hold this valley tightly and expose them to Jesus Christ. If we keep our hope in Jesus Christ, the way that we live, the way that we have our hope in Jesus, the way we live in freedom affects the atmosphere everywhere we go. As a Christian, as a child of God, you have to understand the authority that you hold on the inside of you as Jesus living there. You affect the atmosphere everywhere you go. If we live in this hope, listen to me, church, if we operate in this hope, we change the atmosphere everywhere we go. If we will be who God's called us to be, if we will be the church, souls will be saved as we go into Sheets. Souls will be saved in Walmart. Bodies will be healed in our neighborhood. Bodies will be healed as we walk through hospitals. Oh, Jesus. Minds will be renewed in schools and on the street corner if we live in this hope. Where do you place your anchor? Do you place your anchor in? Real hope is based on God's word, not on wishes. Can I tell you there are over 7,000 promises in the word of God. And if he made the promise, he's not a man that he should lie, but he'll bring it to pass in your life. 7,000 promises that my hope is based in. And if he said I can have it, I can have it, bless God. Certain hope is not based on my emotion, but is based on the fact of God's spoken word. My hope is based on the fact that God cannot lie. God never, 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 never lies. It helps me. Certain hope was the hope that it talks about in Hebrews 6, 13 through 19. God made a promise to Abraham. Because he patiently endured, he saw it come to pass. Listen to me now. God made a promise to Abraham that he would be a father of many nations. How many of you know that Abraham died before he saw the complete fulfillment of all those nations? How many of you know? Let me ask you a question. When God gives you a word, you're guaranteed that he can bring it to pass. Who said that all God promised you would happen in your lifetime? What about the generations that follow us? What about our kids and our grandkids? My God, listen, his promises to me are bigger than my life. That's why Abraham was assured that all that God promised him, he'll bring it to pass. I may not see it physically, but my God is so large and his plan is so big, I may not see it, but my grandkids and my great-grandkids and my great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandkids will see it.
I want a plan so big in my life that it has to outlive me. I want a plan so big that I can't see all that God has for me. It is that big. Why? Because He gave me 7,000 promises in His Word. I want my grandsons and my granddaughters to take up where we leave off, bless God. I want our ceiling to be their floor. I want them to start walking where we left off. Oh, that helps me this morning. And my hope in Jesus Christ is just that. That if He's given me a word, and if I don't see it in my lifetime, God is not a man that He should lie. If I don't see it in my lifetime, then my grandsons will pick it up. If it doesn't happen for me, my granddaughters will pick it up, or my great-grandsons or my great-great-granddaughters will pick it up. That's the hope I have in Jesus Christ. Oh, I hope this is helping you this morning. God cannot lie. He cannot lie. In Luke 18:1, New Century Translation, Jesus taught His followers that they should always pray and never lose hope. That they should always pray and never quit, never give up. How do we never lose hope? How is it that we never lose hope? The only way we never lose hope is by the one that we're anchored in. It's by the one that we're anchored in. Well, Pastor, I'm thankful for this message of hope, but how do I apply this word of hope every day in my life since I live in such an uncertain time? And we do. We live in uncertain times. I'm uncertain about my job. I'm uncertain about my children, whether they're living right or not. I'm uncertain about who's going to be in the White House. I'm uncertain if I'll even have a home tomorrow. And I know these are terrible things. These are big things. But can I tell you, can I just ask you a question? If you have Jesus in your life, does it really matter if you have a home? I know that's hard. I really do. But if my hope is in Jesus Christ, He's going to take care of me. His word said He'd never leave me and never forsake me. His word said He would not leave me as an orphan, but He would come to me. So even if I don't have a home, I have a home in Him, and He'll cover me and shelter me. Oh, well. But how is it? How is it that we apply this every day? This is how certain hope, assured hope, comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Everything else is just false hope. It's wishful thinking. But I have assured hope in Jesus Christ. Amen. But my pastor, my job, let me ask you something. Many are living in fear this morning. Well, I heard they're going to have cutbacks at my job. Okay. Do you think God is able to sustain you in that job? Okay, let's say you go in tomorrow and you get your unemployment slip. Okay, you're done. Do you think God, if He was able to give you that job, you think He can give you another job? My God has no limits. In fact, sometimes He will excuse you from this job because He has something better for you over here. I'm going to hit this one. I'm going to get this one. I like this. If you will be faithful with the job that you're qualified for, it just could be He'll give you a job that you're not qualified for over here. Well, now that doesn't make sense, but that's my God. That's my hope. Sometimes God takes great pleasure in giving you something that other people desire. You're not even qualified for it, but God said, this is my blessed one. This is my chosen one. This is the one who finds their hope in me. I take great delight in blessing my children. Sometimes God picks from the back of the line. I know who man's pick would be, but God said, oh no, I don't want that one. I want that one way back there.
Because they were faithful here. That's how we apply this every day, is to have a relationship in Jesus Christ. And when we have that relationship in Jesus Christ, it's assured hope. I'm almost finished, JD, if you come. Who is your hope in? Who do you place your hope in? Is it hope in yourself, hope in a loved one? Or is it in Jesus? Why is hope in Jesus so vital? Because it's only in Jesus Christ that salvation is assured. Amen. It's only by Jesus Christ that your salvation is assured. Yes, thank you, Jesus. The Lord dealt with my heart as I studied this. Your deliverance is assured in the hope of Jesus Christ. Listen to me. I don't care if you're addicted to pain pills. I don't care if you're addicted to heroin. I don't care if you're addicted to alcohol, pornography, self-destruction, eating disorder. I don't care what it is. Your deliverance is assured in Jesus Christ. You may have to work at it. It may cost you a little bit, but hear me, your deliverance is assured in Jesus Christ. That's good news. That it's assured in Jesus Christ. Remember, the power of hope comes with the one that is behind your hope. The degree of hope actually increases based on who your hope is founded in. So this morning, now is the time. Now is the time to bring all your doubts, bring all your questions, bring all your fears, all your hurts, all your failures, all your sins to Jesus Christ and place your hope in Him. Yesterday evening, I was going over this message and the Lord dealt with my heart about something. These words were penned in the 1800s. In fact, in the United Methodist Hymnal, it's number 368. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. When darkness veils His lovely face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. His oath, His covenant, His blood supports me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, He then is all my hope and stay. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh church, I await today to hear the trump of God's sound. It means Jesus is coming! When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Somebody give God praise this morning as you stand to your feet. So this morning, who is your hope in? Who's your hope in? If your hope has drifted, come to Him this morning. If you're lost, you don't know Him as your Savior, come to Him. Now is the time of salvation. The scripture I started out with, it says, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. My favor is based upon what Jesus did in the past on the cross. But today is the day of salvation.
That means I must receive him as my Savior and deliverer now. So today, if you need hope, you come. If your soul needs saved, you come. If your body needs healed, physically, emotionally, you come now. Or maybe you could just come and thank God that he's given you assured hope in your life. Hope that you can stand on. Hope that you can live by. That regardless of how dark it may get, my hope is found in Jesus Christ. I have assured hope. You come as JD sings this morning.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but hold.
Can you sing this with him this morning?
On Jesus' name, on Christ the Son, rock I stand.
Come to him if you need hope this morning. God wants to do great things in your life if you just come. This altar is open to anybody who wants to come. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
My anchor holds within the veil.
I'll sing that out, church.
Solid.
Thank you, Jesus.
Rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Oh, place your trust in him this morning. Place your trust in him this morning. He holds it all in the palm of his hand. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask Pastor Jay Arn to come and get ready to dismiss the service. I want you to not disrupt anyone around the altar. This altar is open for as long as what people want to stay. My wife and I, we're going to move up to room 204. And if this is your first time here, please, please come up and see us. We would love to just be able to shake your hand or hug your neck and maybe drink a little bit of coffee or tea with you. So please, if this is your first time, please just meet us up there. If you're not sure where it is, just go out in the lobby there to Welcome Center and just ask someone where it's at, and someone will gladly take you up there. Praise the Lord. Pastor Jay, go ahead.
You're welcome to pray around the altar for as long as you like. If you didn't come up and you felt like you should have, it's not too late. We'll have some people to pray up here. So Father, thank you for gathering us here together on this rainy day, but we needed the rain, Lord, just like we needed your word, which we received, just like we needed to worship you, Lord. We thank you that you always give us what we need. We thank you, Lord, and we ask you to watch out over us as we go. Protect us and give us a good day. Bring us back together again tonight as Brother Andre ministers to us. And we know that when we come here together, gathered in your name, that you'll be here to meet us. So, Father, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Bless you, Lord. Amen. You're dismissed.
On on Christ the solid rock I stand.